Hello everyone, we have seen in the first part of the lesson what was the effect of the Franco-Prussian War. And we also came across with a boy named Franz who was late for the school and who was hurriedly going to school and also was scared of getting scolding by the teacher. And as he reached the classroom, he was surprised to see the elderly villager sitting in the back bench. With a heavy heart, Franz learned that it will be the last lesson of his French lessons. He also regretted for not paying much attention to the class and wasting his time going sliding on the sar. Well, let's now continue reading the lesson and understand what the effect the last lesson has made on the little boy Franz. While I was thinking of all this, I heard my name called. The teacher calls out to Franz as he turned to recite the topic of participles. It was my turn to recite. What would I not have given to be able to say that dreadful rule for the participle all through, very loud and clear and without any mistake? Dreadful means frightening. As the news had impacted Franz, he was eager to study so. He was desperate to show his eagerness. He wanted to be able to recite the topic in one go and without any mistake and please his teacher. His desperation is reflected in his willingness to give away all that he had in return for reciting the lesson well. But I got mixed up on the first words and stood there, holding on to my desk, my heart beating and not daring to look up. As Franz did not know the lesson, he got confused and stood quietly. His heart was beating fast, as he was ashamed of himself and did not have the courage to face his teacher. I heard Mr. Hamel say to me, "I won't scold you, little Franz. You must feel bad enough. See how it is. Every day we have said to ourselves, 'Brr, I have plenty of time. I'll learn it tomorrow.' And now you see where we have come out." Mr. Hamel said to Franz that he would not scold him as now he had realized his mistakes. Every day Franz told himself that he would study the next day and now the opportunity to study had ended and he knew nothing. Ah, that's the great trouble with Alsace. She puts off learning till tomorrow. Now those fellows out there will have the right to say to you, "How is it you pretend to be Frenchmen and yet you can neither speak nor write your own language? But you are not the worst, poor little Franz. We have all a great deal to reproach ourselves with." Mr. Hamel says that all the people of Alsace were to be blamed as no one was serious towards learning. He tells the class that the enemies, who are the enemies? Prussians, would laugh at them and say that they only show to be Frenchmen, they pretend to be Frenchmen, as they can neither speak nor write their own language. He says that Franz should not feel guilty as everyone is at fault. Your parents were not anxious enough to have you learn. They prefer to put you to work on the farm or at the mills so as to have a little more money. And I have been to blame also. Have I not often sent you to water my flowers instead of learning your lessons? And when I wanted to go fishing, did I not just give you a holiday?" Here, Mr. Hamel says that Franz's parents were not interested in getting him educated. They wanted him to work at a farm or a mill to earn some money. He says that as a teacher, he was not also interested in teaching them. He would send them to his home to water the plants. Sometimes he would declare a holiday and go for fishing. Then, from one thing to another, Mr. Hamel went on to talk of the French language, saying that it was the most beautiful language in the world, the clearest, the most logical, that we must guard it among us and never forget it. Because when a people are enslaved, as long as they hold fast to their language, it is as if they had the key to their prison. In the above paragraph, Mr. Hamel praises their mother tongue, French language, as being the most beautiful, clearest and most logical language in the world. He tells the class to guard their language as it is the only way to free oneself from the prison of slavery. If a person knows his mother tongue well, no one can enslave him. Knowing the mother tongue well as a language is a tool to fight domination. Then he opened grammar and read us our lesson. I was amazed to see how well I understood it. All he said seemed so easy. I think too that I had never listened so carefully, and that he had never explained everything with so much patience. It seemed almost as if the poor man wanted to give all he knew before going away, and to put it all into our heads at one stroke. What does it mean, at one stroke? It means at once or in one go. The teacher took a lesson in grammar. That day, Franz was surprised that he understood the lesson with ease. He felt that he had been attentive and that Mr. Hamel also explained the lesson with a lot of patience. He felt that the teacher wanted to give them all the knowledge he had before leaving. After the grammar, we had a lesson in writing. That day, Mr. Hamel had new copies for us, written in a beautiful round hand. France, Alsace, France, Alsace. They looked like flags floating everywhere in the schoolroom, hung from the rod at the top of our desk. You ought to have seen how everyone set to work and how quick it was. The only sound was the scratching of the pens over the paper. Well, at this time, Franz felt that here was an air of patriotism in the class. The notebooks were like flags of France that were floating all round. The entire class was busy writing, and the only sound that could be heard was that of the pen writing on the paper. Once some beetles flew in, but nobody paid any attention to them, not even the littlest one, who worked right on tracing their fish hooks as if that was French too. Beetles means a large-sized insect, and not even the littlest ones, which means it refers to the pigeons sitting on the roof, who worked right on tracing their fish hooks. What does it mean? It means scratching with their claws. On the roof, the pigeons scooped very low, and I thought to myself, will they make them sing in German, even the pigeons? What is scooped? It's a sound made by the pigeons. Franz wondered that would the Prussians force the pigeon also to change their language and go in German? Here, the writer wants to say that language comes naturally to a being and it cannot be forced upon anyone, be it the pigeons or the Frenchmen. Whenever I looked up from my writing, I saw Mr. Hamel sitting motionless in his chair and gazing first at one thing, then at another, as if he wanted to fix in his mind just how everything looked in that little schoolroom. What's the meaning of gazing? It means looking intently. And fix in his mind means store or keep everything forever. Here, Mr. Hamel wants to memorize the appearance of everything before leaving the classroom. Fancy, for 40 years he had been there in the same place, with his garden outside the window and his class in front of him, just like that. Only the desk and the benches had been worn smooth. The walnut trees in the garden were taller, and the hop vine that he had planted himself twined about the windows to the roof. What's the meaning of worn smooth? It means had worn out and became smooth due to the overuse. And twined means twisted. Hop vine is a type of climber. How it must have broken his heart to leave it all, poor man, to hear his sister moving about in the room above, packing their trunks, for they must leave the country next day. Little boy Franz feels that the teacher must be heartbroken to be sent away from a place where he had spent 40 years of his life. The noises of his sister packing and moving the luggage could be heard from the room upstairs as they had to leave the next day. But he had the courage to hear every lesson to the very last. After the writing, we had a lesson in history. And then the babies chanted their Ba Baby Bo Boo. Mr. Hamel was very courageous and heard the lesson from the entire class. And after the writing, there was a lesson of history followed by phonetics, where they recited the sounds of alphabets. Here, Franz referred to the class as babies because although they were grown up, they were reciting the lesson of phonetics, which is usually done by younger children. So he calls himself and his class to be babies. Down there, at the back of the room, old Hauser had put on his spectacles and holding his primer in both hands, spelled the letters with them. You could see that he, too, was crying. His voice trembled with emotion, and it was so funny to hear him that we all wanted to laugh and cry. Ah, how well I remember it, that last lesson. All at once, the church clock struck 12, then the Angelus. Angelus is a prayer song in the church. The start is marked by the ringing of the bell. At the same moment, the trumpets of the Prussians returning from drill sounded under our windows. Mr. Hamel stood up, very pale, in his chair. I never saw him look so tall. Trumpets is a musical instrument. And what's the meaning of pale? It is used to describe a person's face or skin if it had less color than usual. Why Mr. Hamel's face turned pale? Because he knows that the time had come for the class to get over. He stood straight and motionless, and Franz says that he had never appeared to be so tall. My friends, said he, I, but something choked him. He could not go on. Then he turned to the blackboard, took a piece of chalk, and bearing on with all his might, he wrote as large as he could, Vive la France. Choked means became unable to speak due to strong emotions. Mr. Hamel wrote on the board, Vive la France, which means long live France. Then he stopped and leaned his head against the wall, and without a word he made a gesture to us with his hand. School is dismissed. You may go. Gesture means it's a signal. Mr. Hamel stopped writing and bent towards the wall, and without speaking anything, he signaled the class to leave as the class was over. So that was the explanation of the chapter, The Last Lesson, written by Alphonse Daudet.